Amen. You can be opening once again to Ephesians chapter 4. Paul writes, and he says, that you put off concerning the former conversation the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lusts, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and that you put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness. Note that. In righteousness and true holiness. Last night we declared to you the responsibility of being transformed. And we introduced to you the idea that your transformation is so much in your hands, because you have to decide what it is you're going to believe. What is your walk? What is your approach to the Lord? You have one, whether you realize it or not.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You have a process in your mind that you have embraced as to how you live out this Christian experience. It's full of, this is what I do, and this is how I approach my walk with God, and this is what I believe. And I made the emphasis last night that we must learn to guide our thoughts, to bring them in line with what the Bible says about God's redemption plan. And I pushed that hard, because every other plan outside of what's revealed in the Word of God is vanity, worthless, without truth, without help, without strength, and that's what men come up with. And the only message that lines up with the Word of God, the one that we have to embrace, is the message that preaches Christ Jesus to us as the Son of God, who loved us and gave himself for us. It's a message, as we said last night, of grace and faith. We believe something, and God, without us laboring for, earning for, working for it, freely receives us and then gives us something that we didn't deserve.
Amen.
So the processes of God are tied on our responsibility of faith. But we also have to learn how this thing works, because faith is that statement we make that kind of throws us off. It says a lot, but it doesn't say anything. When we tell you, you have to believe, why do I have to believe? What does God do? Well, Paul has laid out for us the transformation of the believer, how it occurs, and our role in it, what God does, what we do. It's all in the Word of God. It's all here. And so this morning, rather than just declare the responsibility of transformation and the availability of transformation, I want to preach to you on the process of transformation. We'll use the same title as we did last night, The Transforming Christian, Part 2. Transforming Christian, Part 2. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the opportunity that we have to teach and preach your word. And I ask, God, that you would anoint us now to proclaim the truth. And Lord, we're asking for the moving and operation of the Holy Spirit. Give us a demonstration of the Spirit tonight, today, that moving of the Spirit that opens up understanding and secures faith in your word. And Lord, give us the leading and the guiding of your Spirit throughout, and we'll give you all the praise for it. And everybody said amen. And amen. Paul does not give a full dissertation on the message of the cross in every epistle and every letter that he writes. And so, having said that, that means that you and I have to bear the responsibility of traveling through the Bible, traveling through the epistles, and putting together the picture that he paints through his multiple writings. That means you're going to have to, here we go again, that means you're going to have to occupy a lot of time in the Word of God.
Amen.
You're going to have to spend some time in that Bible. You should know what Paul says. Now, I know that not everybody here is a preacher, not everybody here is a teacher, but everybody here is a Christian, and everybody has the same responsibility to believe. And you need to believe what's written in the Word.
Amen.
And we have to labor to understand it, because our minds are still clouded from the fall. We're going to talk about that. Things aren't as clear. We don't think like we should yet.
That's right.
Yeah. Amen.
We're still allowing God to transform us. That's what being a Christian is all about. That's why I didn't call us the transformed Christian. I said the transforming.
Amen.
We're in a process. Amen. And can I say this to you? God loves you while you're in the process.
Amen.
I said He's already accepted you into the beloved. That's why you're in the process. So I know you're going to have good days, and you're going to have not so good days.
Right.
You're going to be on cloud nine, and you're going to be way in the valley. You're going to be buried in the valley.
Amen.
Come on, somebody.
Amen.
And so the processes of Christianity are a long-term issue. For he that hath begun a good work in you will continue to perform it until the day of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
That's the rapture of the church. So until, from this day, until the rapture, you've got a job to do, and that's to be conformed and transformed by the power of God. But you're going to have to study the scripture yourself. Do not take Brother Matt's word for it.
Amen. Amen.
Don't take my word for it.
Amen.
Make sure that our word that we preach lines up with this word of God. Because when you stand before God, you can't say, well, Brother Larson told me this, and Brother Hebert told me that, and Brother Swigert told me this.
Yeah.
You're responsible to search it out yourself. The Bible gives this to you, and I'm stressing it to you. Study to show yourself approved unto God, not to me, not to pastor, not to your wife, not to your husband. You study the written word of God. As I said last night, it is a gift. It holds the answer so that you can say, Lord, I see. Lord, I see. I see what you're trying to tell me. I see what you're trying to bring to me. So it's our responsibility. I want to lay that before you. I want to give it to you. I want to pound it into your heart and your mind. You're going to have to turn off the television and open up the book.
Amen.
And spend time in it and say, Lord, show me what it is. Study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. That's not to just the pastor. That's to the people. God calls us to a study of His Word. And Paul doesn't give us everything in one epistle. If he did, the Bible would be too thick to have been written. And so we've got to travel through the Word and find out what God says. Last night I taught you and I preached to you that if you hear the Word of God about Jesus Christ and you reject Jesus right now, even though He doesn't wipe you off the planet, the wrath of God is abiding on you.
Right.
And that means that sin will have dominion over you and make your life miserable. You'll start living on the plane of death and dying. You were okay until you heard His name. And once you rejected it, honey, you were off to the races. And to be honest with you, you weren't okay.
Amen.
You just thought you were.
That's right.
But when you start, here's the point, when you start resisting the revealed will of God, God's going to take you down faster than before you knew it. Because now it's no longer ignorance, it's willful ignorance. It's, I don't want that. I don't agree with that. I think other than that. And we said last night that when we hear the word of the cross, if we say, if we understand it, oh no, that's not the way, then we're rejecting the revealed will of God, and the powers of darkness will be given access to you even though you're a believer, and the wrath of God will rest upon you, and sin will have dominion over you if you resist and reject the revealed will of God. So we don't want that. We want to line up our hearts and our minds with the revealed will of God. It doesn't matter what, who or who the messenger is, as long as the messenger is preaching the word of God, you can see it for yourself, because as a believer, you have been given the master teacher at conversion. Jesus Christ, through the person of the Holy Spirit, moves into you the minute that you're born again. That's not the same thing as being filled with the Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
But when you're born again, and this is the other thing we said, the power of sin is broken. And we know, first of all, most people get this already, that the penalty for sin is gone. Woohoo! I'm free.
Yes.
Bob Cornell likes to say that's your get out of hell free card. You got that. Come on, somebody. That's a good thing. I said, you got that. You got that. By simply placing your faith in Christ, the penalty for your sin and mine was absorbed by Jesus at Calvary's cross. That means your faith brings you freedom from the penalty of sin. That's called justification. That's where he gives you his righteousness.
Amen.
And this righteousness is greater than any other value of righteousness that's ever been established. Greater than righteousness by the law. Greater than righteousness by men, which is no righteousness at all. You're granted the perfect, wonderful, complete righteousness of Jesus. Yes. His righteous life is imputed into your account when you say Jesus, and that's all you knew. You didn't have to come up with everything as to theology. You didn't have to figure it all out. You didn't have to quote the Bible to the Lord. All you had to say was, Jesus, and I'm in here.
Yes.
And he did, because he looks upon the hearts and the minds of men, and he knows when simple faith is expressed in him, and the penalty of sin was paid. For you, all sin for all time. When we fail, we went through this last night. Forgive me for going back over it, but we need to see it. And when we fail, we don't just say, oh, that doesn't matter. We repent of our failure.
Yes. Yes.
That means we see that we did wrong. We admit that we did wrong. But God hasn't left us without recourse. He doesn't say, oh, just ignore it because I paid for it. He says, acknowledge it.
Right. Right.
Figure it out. This is you. Amen. You got to fix this. So here's how we fix it. I'm wrong. You know, when my wife and I are driving into a new area, and we don't really know where we are, and we both have GPSs, and we both have opinions as to how we should get to where we're going, it's not always a smooth conversation, because when I'm, and I usually do the driving, when I miss the mark and she tells me, one of the first things out of my mouth is, oh, you're right, honey, that's absolutely right. I blew it, I missed the turn, oh, I don't know what I'm doing. Why is it that it's so hard to say those two words, I'm wrong?
Come on.
Am I in the wrong house this morning? You find that easy? I don't. But God says, when you recognize through the Word of God and through the Spirit of God that you've done wrong, you don't ignore it. You say, Lord, I'm wrong. That's repentance. That's admittance to God. You're confessing that you are wrong, and God already knows you're wrong. He already is aware of it, but you admit that you know that you're aware of it by saying, forgive me, and by asking for forgiveness, you return once again to the truth of justification. You return once again to the security of what Jesus did for you at the cross, knowing that 2,000 years ago he already paid for the sin you just confessed to.
Yes, that's right. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Amen.
And God, who is faithful and just, cleanses us from all unrighteousness and treats us as if we had never sinned. So we understand, we should understand, that the penalty for all sin is taken care of. When I fail, I take it to the Lord, I repent of it, I ask forgiveness according to 1 John 1:9. I don't care what anybody is preaching today. That's the revealed will of God in the Word of God. That's the authority of God's Word. And then my righteousness is maintained. Honestly, I never really lose it. But in order to go beyond my failure, I want it wiped out of my mind, and I want it wiped off the books, and I don't want to live with it hanging over my head like the sword of Damocles. I don't want that.
Yes.
Amen.
Right?
Amen.
I want that thing done and away. So I ask God to forgive me, and the penalty for sin has been paid.
Hallelujah. Yes.
You should know that. You should walk in that. Secondly, and here's where we're going today. We ended with this last night. The power of sin, which dominates every human being on the planet. The power of the fall in the inward man. The sin nature. And it its horrifying effects have tainted, bruised, blinded, abused your heart and your mind.
That's
right. Can I just say it? Humanity is one sick puppy.
Come on, brother.
Amen.
Yes.
If you don't believe me, just look around.
That's right.
As I said last night, we're so confused we don't even know what bathroom we're supposed to use. And now we can't even tell people which bathroom to use.
Yeah.
That's just not right.
Amen.
And in a little while, I'll be able to be arrested for preaching
that.
That's just not right. Our minds are bent towards ungodliness, listen, as a result of the fall. Adam introduced to humanity, through his seed, the sin nature. And the sin nature is a corrupting factory. Put on the board, please, if you would, Ephesians 4:22, our first text. But we're told now as a believer, according to the Word of God, that the power of sin, the power of the sin nature, and the power of every effect of sin, I need you to get that the whole body of sin, every aspect of sin, not just the sin nature, but acts of sin, temptation to sin, misunderstandings, wrong attitudes, wrong mindsets, all of it has been defeated by your union with Christ at Calvary. Now you need to get this, and I don't care how strong Satan wants you to believe that those chains that you're in this morning are the chains around your heart, the chains around your mind. On the authority of the Word of God, I declare he that is dead is freed from the sin nature.
Amen.
The power of God is greater, and the grace of God is greater, and the power of God released because of what Jesus did to humanity is greater than any sin or combination of sinful activity or thought could ever be. There is no confusion in heaven. At Calvary, Jesus defeated the power of sin. He didn't just give to us the freedom from the penalty of sin. He gave to us the freedom from the power of sin's grip. You need to know that under the authority of the Word of God, not because I said so, not because I'm excited about it, and I am, but because the Word of God says that on Calvary, Jesus destroyed him that had the power of the devil, or had the power of evil, the devil. He destroyed him, rendered him idle, useless. You need to know that the power of the flesh has already been broken, because they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with its affections and with its lust. You need to know that the power of the sin nature, the sin factory in you, its power was broken. How? When you said yes to Jesus, the Holy Spirit immerses you into Jesus. You become one with him. You're baptized into his death.
Yes.
You're crucified, and that grip of sin can't stay, because it only has its legal right in the old man that you once were outside of Christ. But now that you're in Christ, you're a new man, and sin can no longer reign. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! On the authority of the Word of God, let the chains fall off. You've got to be convinced. And when you're convinced, that is evidenced by the fact that you don't walk in the vanity of your mind and try to deal with your problems your way.
Amen.
What problems? The problems created by being a member of the human race. Now, look at what he says. This is so important. Verse 22. He says, if we believe this, if we know this as a certainty, he says, put off. Now stop there. We got to see the text. It literally means to lay something aside. So whatever it is you just don't seem to get over, he doesn't say fight it. He doesn't say defeat it. He doesn't say win the victory over it. Based on the authority of the Word of God, he says lay it aside. Take it off. This is not a struggle. I'm taking off my coat. This is not a struggle. Put it off. Lay it. Why? Because you can.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Put off the former conversation or concerning the former conversation. What's that? Your old lifestyle.
That's right.
Amen.
Not fight it. Not, oh, I hope someday Jesus will deliver me from Copenhagen. I thought that battle. Oh, I hope you're looking at me funny. I fought a lot of battles. But here's what I learned. The battle was already won.
Amen.
On the authority of the Word of God, whatever it is, get this, whatever it is you're facing that seems insurmountable, whatever giant it is in your character or in your action or in your mind, understand that your union with Christ has already defeated that giant.
Amen.
You've got to believe that.
That's right.
And so, based on that truth, I now lay aside, literally undress myself. I cast this aside. It's not a struggle. I do it because I can.
Amen.
Amen.
What does this mean? It means you don't have to lie anymore.
Yes, right.
I'm going to jump ahead, and could you run this through with me? Let if you have a Bible, go there too. I just want to show you, look at starting in verse 25. Let's show each other what we can put aside now. Let's see. First of all, let's get rid of lying.
Yes. Amen.
Let's put lying aside. See, it's your nature. It was to lie.
Come on.
We catch you in a bad situation. It wasn't me. Your hand is still in the cookie jar. It wasn't me. And you learned to lie. You learned it.
That's right.
You thought that if you lied, life would be better because then you would escape whatever it is that was the consequence.
Amen.
Of what you were lying about.
Amen.
And you taught yourself as a fallen creature that lying was better than telling the truth. So when the opportunity came, lying became like breathing to you.
Yeah. Yeah. Amen.
That's good.
Because here's your mindset, I can keep myself out of trouble by not exposing that I just bit off a big piece of stupid. So I'll misrepresent the truth. That's a lie. I'll cloud it to where, Lord, that woman you gave me, the blame game. I'll lie. I won't just stand up and take personal responsibility. Now, you need to get this. We have taught our minds and our hearts that lying is the way to life. The sin nature was in us, corrupting us with deceitful lusts. And that's crazy, because what that means is, we bought the lie that what we thought we were doing would bring us life, and instead of bringing us life, we adapted to a lifestyle that corrupted our heart and our mind and created strongholds and produced strength, a sinful activity.
Right.
We thought, well, if I do this, I'll have life. We were corrupted. Listen. By deceitful lusts.
Yes.
That means the desire you had to lie fooled you, and you thought, I'm going to get away with this.
Amen. Yes.
I won't pay the price for this. This won't cost me anything.
Yeah.
Are you following this?
Yes.
So in verse 22, when he says, put away the former conversation, what was birthed in you Because your inner man was corrupted through deceitful lust. The sin nature whispers in your ear when you get caught as a child and says, lie about it and you'll be okay.
Yeah.
And you learn to lie. And when the problems come up, you lie.
Yeah.
Because to tell the truth, woo, oh honey, that'll get me in some doggy doo-doo. Get me in some hot water.
Yeah, buddy.
So I figure that lying is better. And my system, my brain, my mind, my heart says every opportunity that I face, lie.
Yeah.
But Paul says, not fight lying, not quit lying, but lay it aside. Know that that's not the route to life. What else is it? Because they all work the same way. Go ahead, go to the next verse, please. Don't be angry and sin not. Let not the sun go down on your wrath. As a believer, you thought that if you stayed mad at somebody for 5 days, you'd get even with whatever it was that
Amen.
They did to you.
Amen.
And if you treated them bad for 7 or 8 days, and you treated them like they had treated you, that was the way to get even.
Amen.
That was the way to get your pound of flesh. When you were treated ugly, you got ugly.
Amen.
Or when you just thought you were treated ugly. Or when you just felt like you were treated
yeah.
ugly,
yeah.
then in your
Amen.
Mind, in your heart, what I do is I ugly back.
Yeah.
I was ugly, and now I'm going to ugly back.
Yeah.
Even when you weren't really ugly, you were acting ugly because in your mind, in your heart, that's the way I'm going to get life. That's the way I'm going to get my satisfaction. That, are you getting this?
Oh, yeah.
And the sin nature gave us that design, and we bought it hook, line, and sinker, and we allowed it to become a deceitful lust in our lives, and we thought, oh, well, when somebody does me bad, I do them worse, and that'll bring
Amen.
That's good.
Life.
Amen.
No. Don't hold any anger. You want to get angry. People are going to treat you bad, but whatever it is, don't ugly them back, because that's a deceitful lust burned into your system by a sin nature that was once active and had dominion over you.
Good.
All right, let's go on. Don't give place to the devil. He likes to give you suggestions.
Come on.
And he likes to operate in your system. The devil can talk to you just like the Holy Spirit can. So you better start lining up your activity with the Word of God. And when he whispers a suggestion to you, according to 1 John 4:1, you recognize it. Beloved, try the spirits to see, what is that of the devil or is that of the Lord? Is this is what is? And now don't get a bracelet and say, is this what Jesus would do?
No,
that won't help you.
Come on.
But recognize that this is not this is not me anymore.
Amen.
I was taught this to give place to the devil. Next verse. Oh yeah, here's a good one. Stop stealing.
Yeah.
Stop pilfering at work.
Uh-oh.
The pens, the papers, the paper clips. Pilfering is small stuff. It's not grand theft.
Yeah.
But it's stealing.
Amen.
And the Holy Ghost says to you, stop stealing. But see, in your mind, oh, it's just a little thing, so it really doesn't matter. And God knows I work so hard at this office, and he understands that my desk at home doesn't have a box of paper clips. And so I think that without my boss loves me, and even if he treated me bad, but I'm taking those paper clips home. Mm-hmm. What are you doing? I'm doing that because I'm preaching better than you are. And we thought that stealing would bring us a life. But it was a deceitful lust by the sin nature corrupting my mind, but teaching me that this is how I get life. I steal. I take what doesn't belong to me. I rob somebody. I take what somebody else works. I'm dishonest with my labor. I know that I was sleeping for 2 hours on the job because I couldn't get caught.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It's stealing.
That's right.
That's good preaching,
I'm preaching better than you.
Yes. Praise God.
Aren't you glad you came to church?
Amen.
But rather, let's. Here's what we don't steal. Don't stop stealing. He says this to Christians. Why? Because we have been trained by the sin nature and deceived into believing that these actions produce life, and then we justify those actions in our minds.
Yes.
All right. Let's go to the next. Corrupt communication. Okay. This is a pet peeve. Cussing Christians. This is what that addresses. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth. We learn to exclaim and proclaim certain words whenever we were dissatisfied in the world. I'm not going to give you the example. Thank you. Because you know exactly what I'm talking about. Because you thought that the way to express yourself, I don't know where it came from, but you know, cussing like a sailor, I don't know if a sailor cusses, but that all, you know what? And did you ever notice that we always cussed not in the name of Buddha, but in the name of Jesus Christ? That ought to tell you the source.
Amen.
Behind the impetus to misuse and abuse that precious name. The only name that can save is the only God that's used as a cuss word. And Satan couples and we cuss and we blankety blank 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 blank. Blankety blank blank blank. Hit your nail or hit your thumb while you're nailing something. I can't do that because I so I don't cuss because I was 26 when I lost those, so I know what it's like to get. We thought that if we proclaimed our feelings in this garbage language, that we'd get our point across. So we let that string of obscenity slip out of our mouth, and we would use it as insults to anybody that's around us. And this is what brings me life. When I can cuss harder and longer and cuss you out and make you feel like a dog, that'll make life. That'll give me life. Put off corrupt. Lay it aside. This isn't you anymore.
Amen.
Okay. All right. But instead, use your lips for something that ministers grace.
Praise God.
Yeah, see, bring, you know, the people ought to hear something come out of your mouth that doesn't act like what we used to because we were deceived by deceitful lusts. All right, good. So we lay aside. Let no one go ahead. Next verse. Grieve not the Holy Spirit. Hmm. What's that mean? That means that you don't let him have his way. He knocks on your heart's door and says, stop stealing. He knocks on your heart's door and says, stop cussing. Well, they deserve it. He knocks on your heart door and says, stop stealing. Well, I deserve it. Don't grieve the Holy Spirit. When he leads you into the paths of righteousness, follow him. Amen. Don't push him away. Yeah. Don't silence him. He'll tell you what's wrong with you as much as he'll tell you what's right with you.
Amen.
And the two need to be balanced out, but we've got to hear it. So don't grieve him. When you trust in anything other than Christ and the Holy and Christ and the cross, you grieve the Holy Spirit. You frustrate the grace of God from your life.
Amen.
And you've got to have the grace of God. Are we getting all this?
Yeah.
Okay, let's go on. Let's go a little further. Okay, and all of these, I could give you examples, but take bitterness. Wait a minute, that's how you used to respond to the circumstance. Because you thought that being angry with everybody in your life is what would bring you life. You were being deceived by corrupted design and desire. And you were fooled, you didn't even see that it was tearing you apart to be full of bitterness.
That's right.
Yes, it was.
Full of wrath and anger and clamor, evil speaking, malice. You want that person to die, and you'd like to do it and tell God they slipped. Malice, you want to hurt somebody. Because when I hurt him, then I'll finally feel good. I'll have life. It's a corruption from the inward man. when you are out of control and under the control of the sin nature, and it has fooled your heart and mind as to how you act and how you live. This is good teaching.
Amen.
All right, one more. And be, see, now we're going where we're supposed to go. Be kind one to another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God, for Christ's sake, hath forgiven you. All right, back to verse 22, and thank you for doing this. I want you to see this.
Amen.
Now, verses 25 through the end of the chapter detail all these things that we have been trained in, and I think you began to recognize some of the ways that you're even now still responding to the situations of life and the activities of life, and there's this big "I'm guilty" stamped on your forehead. Good.
Amen.
Amen.
I went to church this morning and I got convicted. Good. And the Word is doing its job on you and on me. I'm not going to this process, Pastor. I'm not all the way through this.
That's right.
But now, do you get what I'm saying and what Paul's saying? He doesn't say, defeat lying and all the list. He doesn't say, you overcome it in willpower. He says, lay it aside. Why? Because lying and everything else on that list was already overwhelmed by the power of God's grace when you were united with Christ at Calvary. Therefore, you don't have to lie anymore, but you are going to have to learn that you cannot lie.
That's right.
Are you getting what I just said? You're going to have to learn that lying is not the procedure to bring your life. Now watch. The old man, the old person is me, dominated by sin and the sin nature, all aspects of sin, which was corrupt according to what? These wrong desires that I had that deceived me into thinking that that's what brings life. You, Pavlov's dog. Everybody knows about Pavlov's dog, right?
Yeah.
Psychology 101, high school, you got it, whether you wanted it or not. Okay, well, some of you look like you might not have had Pavlov's dog. So Pavlov's dog was the dog they used to experiment with, and they rang a bell and gave him a steak. They rang a bell and gave the dog a steak. And every time they rang a bell, the dog began to get trained in his mind and in his spirit that when the bell rang, the steak was coming. And he would begin to saliva, drool all over the place, because he knew in 10 seconds after the bell, he was trained to see and understand that 10 seconds after the bell, he got the steak. And so one day they hit the bell and didn't give him the steak, and he's still sitting there drooling, acting, because he thinks one thing follows another. You have been so corrupted by the fall that when the bell rings,
yes, that's right. That's good.
You respond the way you've always responded.
Come on, amen.
You think the way you always thought. You react, Christian, the way you always react. It's your first inclination is to do whatever it is that the sin nature deceiving you poured into your spirit and into your mind. Am I coming home here?
Yes.
Amen.
And when you're born again, even though you're freed from all, listen, you're freed from the dominion, you don't have to lust after something anymore.
Yes.
Now, I would suggest that you don't put pornography in front of your eyes.
Amen.
That would help. But the pornography wasn't the problem. The problem was the lust in your heart. You satisfied it through pornography. The problem wasn't the internet. The problem was the lust in your heart. You satisfied it through the internet. You satisfied it through the old bookstores and the adult or whatever. You satisfied it that way through illicit sex. You satisfied that old desire. That was you.
Yeah.
Now, how you because you had a desire. Did you know that you have corrupted natural desires on the inside of you as a believer?
That's right.
And I know I'm in mixed company and it's different ages. I'm trying to be really careful here. But God was the author of sexual activity. He made it okay under the realm of a man marrying a woman.
Amen.
And sex is meant to procreate. And advance the seed. God is the one that introduces this. But we have been trained that whenever I feel a natural desire, I can meet it in an illegitimate way, and that's okay. Come on, somebody. And so we react when we have the need. I have needs. Yes, you do. But those are natural and they're to be met here. And God will give you grace. Come on, somebody.
Amen.
To help you until that status is yours.
That's
or
right.
He'll give you the gift of singleness.
Amen.
So,
amen.
That's right. But you've been trained through the movies.
Yeah.
You can't watch a movie without seeing two belly buttons bumping together. You can't go to a commercial without them selling you a car with a half-naked girl on the top of it. What, you buy the car, you get the girl? That's what you... See, you're being trained. You're being trained in your heart and your spirit and your mind, thinking, well, if I buy that car, I'll get all the girls. And you have that desire because God gave you a desire to have a family, raise a godly seed. That's how it's supposed to bear out.
Amen.
But you've learned it another way. Now here's the good news. That strong desire that rises up in you, whether it be for whether it's for a fork, something that you eat,
amen,
or something that you sleep with.
Amen.
Yes. Amen.
That power was broken.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
And you don't have to respond that way anymore.
Amen.
Put this aside. You got to recognize it, though, don't you?
Yes.
I hope some of you are starting to see that some of the stuff on the inside of me is, well, I just always in that way. It's time to change,
amen,
baby. It's time to let God begin to change us. Watch. Go to verse 23. I got to hurry here. I'm almost done, and that means absolutely nothing.
Yeah.
And be renewed. You know what it means to be renewed? It means that that portion of you that was once diseased, out of hat, thinking the wrong way, is swept out of your character.
Amen.
Yes.
Okay? We just had a lot of flood going on in Baton Rouge. I don't know how much it hit down, but Baton Rouge, Grace and Skylar, they had to move out of their home. They're living with us, them and their dogs. Pray for me. I didn't have a dog for a reason.
Amen.
But I love Skylar and Grace. You know, fleas don't come with the dogs. The kids came with the dogs. So they're staying with us. But when the flood came and the houses were damaged, even if the water just came in for 6 to 8 inches, you had to take 2 feet from the ground and cut the whole house out.
Yeah.
Then you had to scrape all the tile and the flooring off.
Yeah.
Then you had to get it out. And then, listen, then you had to treat it before you could build anything. You know what that they call that? Renovating.
Yes.
You know what it means to renew? The spirit of your mind? It's time that you tore out the old way of thinking.
Amen.
It's time that you cleaned up the inside of the house.
Yes.
It's time that you got a little Holy Ghost treatment.
Amen.
Come on.
Amen.
That's good.
Yes.
That's good. So that something precious and new can come in and replace the damaged portion of your house. You are the temple of the Holy Spirit. But yet there's a renovation that needs to happen in both your heart and your mind, because you've been corrupted into thinking that certain attitudes and actions and patterns of action will bring you life. And it's a lie. It's a deceitful lust. It doesn't produce life. It produced death and dying. Are you following me? And yet, Jesus says, guess what we get to do now? Now that we've been set free, it's time to put this off.
Yes. Amen.
Now this is going to take some time, because as Brother Swagger likes to say, we're squirreled up. We're messed up.
Yes.
Look at your friend. Look at your neighbor. Say, you're messed up. Okay, if you don't do it, I'm going to stand right here till you all do it. Look at your friend, tell him, you're messed up. Come on, out of your mouth, look at him and say, you're messed up.
You're messed up.
Now look at yourself, say, I'm messed up too.
I'm messed up.
But God.
Yes.
But God.
Yes.
But God.
Yes.
But God sent his only begotten Son, not just so that I could be freed from the penalty of sin.
Yes.
But I could be freed now from the dominion of sin and these deceitful lusts that have been birthed in me by the power of the sin nature, and my wrong reaction and my wrong action and my wrong thinking can now be renovated. Now it's important we see it in the spirit of your mind. The word for mind usually in the Greek is psuche, just meaning soul, the inward portion of the mind. But this is the word nous, N-O-U-S, transliterated. And what it indicates is something far more than just the thinking. It's the whole inward man. The heart, the mind, the desire, the process of thought. He says, be renewed in the whole of your inward being. Every single thing in us needs to be torn out, cleaned up. Why? Because I'm a new creation.
Amen.
In Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Old things pass away. Behold,
amen.
I want my house to be new.
Yes.
I said, I want my house to be new.
Yes.
I want renewed, renovation.
Yes.
I want that old junk that's causing death and dying out, and I want the new in.
Yes. Amen.
I need me some treated timber and some brand new drywall.
Amen.
Now, the word renewed is important, too. In the Greek, this is, I'm not trying to tell you how smart I am, because I got it from somebody else. I'm not a Greek scholar. Renewed is in the passive tense. And what that means is that the subject is being acted upon.
Yes.
So you can't renew yourself.
That's right.
Amen.
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 You've got to have a flow of the one that does the renewing.
Yeah. Amen.
Amen.
Can you put Titus 3 and 5 on the screen? You're doing a great job. Titus 3 and verse 5. I want you to see this. Because God promises that not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy he saved us by the washing of regeneration.
Amen.
And the renovation. Come on, somebody.
Yes, yes.
The renewing, listen, of the Holy Spirit. Do you know what the Holy Spirit will do? He will renew. That's it. Now we're back to Ephesians 4:23. He'll renew you in the spirit of your mind. He'll tear out those old thought processes. He's got to expose you to you.
Yes.
And thank God he does most of that behind the curtain.
Amen.
If you listen to him, the Holy Spirit will expose you to you. And when he exposes you to you, you go, Lord, forgive me.
Yes.
I repent of that wrong attitude. Create in me. Renew. Create in me a clean heart. So when the opportunity comes and I'm used to lying to produce life, instead I humble myself and I tell the truth, and I start to learn that God honors that, and instead of coming out behind like I have been because I'm lying, I start telling the truth, and I'm living on a plane of life and living. I'm not giving you half representation or half truth now, because I've laid aside lying. I'm being renewed renovated by the Holy Spirit, who says, stop that. It's not going to produce life for you. Stop that. That's a deceitful lust. Stop that. That's not what God wants for you. Stop that. That won't bring God's best. And now I'm responding to that. I'm being renewed in the spirit of everything that I think about, all that I do. My response to every single thing in my life has to fall under, how does God say I'm to respond to it?
Exactly. Hallelujah. That's right.
Transforming the Christian.
Yes.
Our houses have been flooded by sin. But God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, not just so that I could be free from the penalty of sin, but so that I could also be free from the power of sin and all its effects.
Yes. Amen.
Well, how do I get the Holy Spirit to move? How do I get removed? How do I renew? If it's not me doing it, how do I get Him to do it? Great question. The only thing that'll bring grace, which is what you need to be renewed, is
faith.
Bible students. And faith has to be in God's redemption plan.
Amen.
Lord, I can't stop lying. It's in me. I'm used to it. I've fallen prey to it, but it's wrong. But I believe that 2,000 years ago on Calvary, You broke the power of the lie.
Yes.
And I don't have to lie.
That's right.
In response to life or circumstance or situation. I no longer have to steal. I no longer have to fornicate. I don't have to fall prey to the feelings inside that I have that were corrupted by the sin nature. I don't have to give in to that. I don't have to give in to that drug. I don't have to give in to clamoring and slandering and bitterness and I don't have to give in to that.
Amen.
Because 2,000 years ago, Jesus, You defeated that.
Amen.
You defeated my lying
Amen.
Spirit.
Yeah.
You defeated that. You defeated that.
Amen.
And your faith in who He is and what He did for you. Did you know He did this for you?
Amen.
He came and died not just to pay the penalty for your sin, but to free you from all the
Hallelujah.
Corrupted lust that the sin nature and the fall have affected in your heart and mind. So now that when you see it, you don't say, okay, I'm going to pray that out. I'm going to fast that out. I'm going to go to a psychologist and get that out of me. You say, Lord, there's nothing any man can do because
Amen.
I've been corrupted by the fall. I'm fleshly
Amen.
And in and
Amen.
Of myself.
Amen.
I've got no help. Oh, wretched man that I am, who
yes.
shall
Amen.
Deliver me
yes.
from the body of this death?
Yes.
Wait a
yes.
minute. I thank God.
Yes.
I don't have to remain the same because of what Jesus did for me at Calvary. My faith in what He did produces the grace of God, and the grace of God, the power of the Holy Spirit, brings the renewing, the renovation, the clean out
yes,
of the person I used to be dominated by. So this is so good.
Yes.
One more verse and we're done. Verse 24. And that you put on. See, we're not just getting rid of something.
Yes.
We're getting dressed.
Yes.
Amen.
He didn't just strip us down to nothing so that we could be embarrassed.
Thank you, Jesus.
He's putting new clothes on us.
Thank you, Jesus.
Woo!
That's good.
He's putting new garments
Hallelujah.
On.
Yes.
Instead of lying, there's truth there.
Yes.
Instead of stealing, there's labor there, work there, both for yourself and for the kingdom of God, that God can bless the plane of life and living, not death and dying.
Yes.
Amen.
There's a mouth that's ministering grace to the hearers now.
Hallelujah.
Not a mouth that's full of corruption.
That's good.
And there's a blessing coming from the Lord because now you're responding the way that a born-again person who's being renewed through faith and grace is supposed to, by putting off the old man and putting,
Amen.
You're getting... Now you're getting dressed.
Amen.
And you look a lot like somebody who walked in this
Hallelujah.
Earth 2,000 years ago. And you're not, I confess it, I claim it. No. You're a poor, pitiful human being subject to what the fall brought. But 2,000 years ago, Jesus died on Calvary to release you from the penalty of sin and the power of sin.
Yes.
And now knowing that when I see what needs to be renovated in me, I don't give up hope. I don't give up faith. I keep saying, Jesus, I can't change this about myself. You change it in me. I don't just act like I think I need, like I used to. I don't go out and do that. But if I do, and some of us still do.
That's right.
Yes.
Amen.
Wrong. All of us on some level are still acting like we used to act.
Yes.
That's right.
Because we haven't been totally renovated yet. But I, even though I haven't yet apprehended, even though I have not yet attained, this one thing I do.
Amen.
Amen.
I press.
Yeah.
I let God work.
Yeah.
I don't try to get it done myself. I don't try to accomplish it in the flesh. I'm operating by faith in Christ and what He did for me at the cross. And I'm putting off, laying aside the old way of thinking and the old way of reacting. And I'm being renewed, rebuilt in my spirit man, so that now, instead, when my wife tells me something that used to just make me crazy angry, I'm just slightly angry. I'm getting better.
Amen.
Amen. Yes. Come on, somebody.
Yes.
And there's coming an hour when she's going to do the same thing, and I'll go, you know, that's the way it is. Not because I'm senile. I'm renewed. I don't respond exactly the same. I'm learning. That's what it means to put off and put on.
Yes.
Faith. This is practical.
Yes.
But it's faith in Christ and the cross that brings the renewing power of the Holy Spirit. And though the outside man is dying day by day, the inward man is being renewed.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Day by day. And the end result is, with my faith in Christ, I have righteousness that's imputed. Now, I love these two words. I was sitting in the motel this morning and it hit me. And true holiness.
Yes.
Not holiness because I dress right.
That's right.
Not holiness because I do have a beard, don't have a beard.
Come on.
Wear a dress, don't wear a dress.
Right.
Wear pants, don't wear pants. Wear makeup, don't wear makeup.
That's good.
Not false holiness, a true holiness that comes as a result of the renewing and washing of the Holy Spirit who works in me as a result of my faith in Christ and what He did for me at Calvary. And there's not one thing that you used to be dominated by, not one wrong reaction, not one wrong thought, that Jesus did not defeat. Not a one.
Amen.
Everybody and anybody can be free from everything and anything because you are completed in Christ. If you fight the fight of faith, you understand this process, not get discouraged as you go through it. He's going to bring you from point A to point B. And when He's done with you, oh, I hate to steal the commercial, but you're going to like the way you look.
Thank God.
I guarantee you, on the authority of the Word of God, you're going to like the way you look. And you know, the people around you are going to recognize that you're no longer living on that plane of death and dying. You're living on a plane of life and living, and there's something different about you. And you can say it's all because of who He is.
Amen.
And what He's done. Would you stand?